Wayne Williams, who is 23, was formally indicted today by a grand jury in Atlanta. Two separate indictments accusing Williams of two murders. Williams' lawyer, and we'll be hearing from her a little later, calls the indictments a charade. And she says sources close to the prosecution have told her that Wayne Williams will be indicted for even more of the 28 killings that have terrified Atlanta and horrified much of the rest of the world over the past 2 years. Here's Bob Serkin now with an update of today's events.
Count number one, causing the death of Jimmy Ray Payne by asphyxiating him with objects and by means which to the grand jury are unknown. Second count, accusing Mr. Williams of murder of Nathaniel Tatum.
The indictment of Wayne Williams was handed down by a 25-member Fulton County grand jury. It had been hearing evidence in the case since early last week. District Attorney Lewis Slayton presented several witnesses, police investigators, a forensic scientist, and the mother of Wayne Williams. The evidence was enough to indict Williams for not only one, but two of the 28 murders of young black adults. The 23-year-old Williams became a suspect on the morning of May 22nd. Williams was seen driving across this bridge, moments after a police stakeout team heard a splash in the Chattahoochee River. A few days later, the body of Nathaniel Cater surfaced downstream. Williams was stopped, questioned, and released, but police and the FBI kept him under constant surveillance until his arrest. On April 27th, 500 yards from where Cater's body was found, the body of 21-year-old Jimmy Ray Payne surfaced in the river. He, too, had been strangled. When investigators searched Wayne Williams' house, they found certain textile fibers and dog hairs on his clothing and in his car. They matched evidence found on the bodies of the victims. Bloodstains found in the car also matched up. Witnesses have placed Williams with the victims at various locations. Defense lawyers have accused the district attorney and police of holding Williams on insufficient evidence and acting under political pressure.
And I hope like hell that they have more than some more fibers and just the fact that, Wayne Williams was on a bridge at a time when, you know, 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning.
As for Williams, he reportedly is taking the publicity and the indictment in stride. He waits in an isolated jail cell for his day in court. It will come in early October.
Meanwhile, investigators are seeking accomplices, working under the premise that Wayne Williams could not have acted alone. Also being pursued, alleged links between Williams and other victims. More indictments are possible. Bob Serkin, ABC News, Atlanta.
Bob Serkin is standing by live in Atlanta right now. Bob, how many more, and I don't know if officials are even talking in terms of numbers, but how many more involvements do they believe Williams may have?
Well, originally investigators here speculated that Wayne Williams could be involved in as many as 12 to 18 murders. We know of links being pursued in 5 or 6 other cases, but no additional charges seem imminent against Williams. There are other counties in suburban Atlanta pursuing other cases against Williams. They're investigating them.
Bob, you've been covering this story for as long as it's been going on. I'm wondering, do you get the sense that there is any legitimacy to the charges that Williams' lawyer has been making, namely that there is a great deal of political pressure? How much response to the political pressure, or how solid do you think their case, not how solid do you think it is, how solid do they seem to think it is?
Well, Ted, I have to believe that Lewis Slayton, the Fulton County District Attorney, and some of the investigators would like to have a more solid case than they have now. Slayton was never happy in the beginning with all this circumstantial evidence, and they wanted more solid evidence in the form of witnesses who could place Williams with some of the victims before their deaths. They have some of that, but I think that the building process toward the trial continues, and this fibrous evidence, while it matches, no one is quite sure as to how precisely accurate and how precisely perfect it is under the microscope.
All right, Bob Serkin, thank you very much indeed. Wayne Williams was not entirely unknown in the Atlanta community, and although his career shows signs of eccentricity, many of those who knew him were shocked when he became a murder suspect. We have a report on the background of Wayne Williams from correspondent Jim Hickey.
Born and raised in Atlanta, the 23-year-old Williams had been living with his parents on the city's northwest side until his arrest. He appears to be an enterprising businessman and claims to own a partnership and a talent agency. In fact, his resume says his life goal is to bring new persons into the entertainment field and develop them into quality professionals. It is a business which would put him in constant touch with young people. Williams is known to be extraordinarily bright. Archie Wilson, his seventh grade teacher, remembers Williams had a special interest in science and photography and excelled in his schoolwork.
Any assignments he was given, he would always do well. And he was an exceptional student. So I guess one would say that he was curious. And most bright students appear to be very curious to the average person.
While still a high school student, Williams developed a keen interest in radio and television. At 15 years old, with financial help from his father, he built and operated a low-power radio station, WRAZ, in their home. One of those Williams went to for advice was Scotty Andrews, an Atlanta radio executive. Andrews says he was amazed at Williams' knowledge of the broadcasting business.
He's the engineer, the general manager, the program director, sales manager. To talk to a kid that age about something that you're doing as an adult, and he's talking on your level, you know, and I'm talking about going through the rating books, talking about cumes and this and the quarter hour averages and that kind of thing. It's really amazing.
Williams soon earned the reputation as a likable young media groupie. In the late 70s, he worked for several Atlanta radio stations on a part-time basis. He also became a freelance cameraman for local television stations. This film is an example of his work. He covered mostly spot news, such as fires, accidents, and homicides, often late at night. Williams apparently was also a police groupie. He monitored police calls in his own car, was once arrested for impersonating a police officer, and claims to have been an arson photographer for the Atlanta Fire Department.
His nighttime activities and his thorough knowledge of police procedures are just two of the reasons why investigators here in Atlanta began to consider Williams a prime suspect.
But Williams claims those factors are merely coincidental, just tools to do his job. And at a news conference where he refused to have his picture taken, Williams told reporters that because of his talent agency, it is not unusual for young blacks to be seen in his car. He even produced an agency contract to prove his point.
Performing arts manager, and these are just some of the contracts that we use in the business. It's our job to take some entertainers, say, basically from the street, polishing them up, get them professional, and try and shop a record deal for them. What we're trying to do is just capture the marketplace, basically, that Jackson 5 had.
Williams is not very big, only 5 feet 7 inches tall, though some detectives have voiced private concerns that he might be too small to have committed the crimes. Investigators are now convinced that Williams, the police-wise broadcasting whiz kid, is their man. Jim Hickey, ABC News, Atlanta.
Mary Welcome is an Atlanta attorney who has represented Wayne Williams since he first became a suspect in the killings. Today she insisted anew that Williams is completely innocent. Ms. Welcome is standing by live now in our Atlanta bureau. Ms. Welcome, it is, I suppose, a lawyer's job to insist that her client is innocent, but what can you tell us that would be convincing? I mean, the police seem to have rather convincing evidence that he may not be.
Well, let's start with number one. Let's start with the presumption that he is innocent. He is clothed with the presumption of innocence. He says that he is innocent. I believe that he is innocent based upon my personal contact with him. And then the final thing is that when we look at the kind of evidence that is being relied on to get him involved in the criminal justice system, the fact that we have law enforcement officials who have been working long hours for nearly 2 years, for them to rely on circumstantial evidence, a loud splash, and some threads or some fibers to cause a man to go through the criminal justice system certainly is not indicative of a man who is guilty of murder.
Ms. Williams, whatever one may think of the evidence, it was clearly compelling enough that a grand jury today brought down two indictments, murder indictments, against him. What are you saying about the grand jury?
I don't think that you can say that it was compelling. I think what you have
I said compelling enough.
Right, compelling enough. I suppose what you mean would be convincing enough. Certainly the presence of the Fulton County District Attorney, who makes an unusual appearance, the fact that they have read so much about what appears to be links to the crimes of Wayne Williams' involvement, the fact that they have nothing more than circumstances placing him at a place. They can't even say how he died. They don't know whether Wayne Williams threw him off the bridge that night or whether someone killed him some other time. What they had was accusations, and that, I think we must understand, is the role of the grand jury. They're an accusatory body, and that is a far cry from believing that he is guilty of these crimes.
All right, you are sketching out now, and you have sketched out earlier today, a picture of a climate, an environment in Atlanta that might make it very difficult for your client to get a fair trial. Why then is it, and I've heard that you are not thinking about change of venue, why not?
That is not correct. We have not made a final decision. I have said on numerous occasions that there are pros and cons to a request for a change of venue, as there are pros and cons to staying. What I say about Atlanta is the fact that because Atlanta is the place where these crimes were committed, they have a vested interest in what happens in this trial. And they have a desire and that compelling need to make sure that the man that is brought to trial is, in fact, not based upon circumstantial evidence, but is, in fact, guilty. And it may well be that a jury here may hold the prosecutorial feet to the fire and convince them that this man is guilty, not on just circumstances, but they will ask for and demand more than just these fibers and the loud splash.
But surely you're not saying that the political pressure is enough that they are knowingly bringing an innocent man in and that a grand jury knowingly indicted an innocent man.
When you look at the circumstances surrounding what has happened, you ask, why else? And that is what we will seek to find out. Why else would they bring an innocent man based upon this kind of circumstantial evidence when all the brilliant minds have had an opportunity to do more? They have no motive. They have no venue, no place where the crimes have committed. They have no eyewitnesses. They have nothing except what you have read, fibers and a loud splash.
All right, Mary, welcome. Thank you very much for joining us, and I appreciate very much your taking the time.
Thank you.